What's poppin', everybody, and welcome to another exciting edition of High School Football Classics. I'm Petros Papadakis, and tonight we have another very exciting matchup. Our theme this week is sleeper teams. Teams from Orange County especially that are not modern day, but are still playing, as our dear hero Gary Paskowitz would say, good football. And we have a very special guest, a great one, joining us, our analyst on the Game of the Week, just finished his first year, which was a huge success. He is the West Coast expert for recruiting for 24/7. He knows everything top to bottom, a great talent and a great advocate for young men getting to college. It is our guy, Greg Biggins. Biggie, what's cracking? How are you?
Hey, what's up? Good. I'm good, P. How are you doing?
I'm fabulous. Now, what is going on right now as far as your work? How is it being impacted by all the different things going on? And what is it that you are doing day to day?
So my job hasn't changed. Obviously, recruiting right now, honestly, it's crazier than ever, if you can believe that. There's actually twice at the same stage as it was last year, twice as many commitments right now as it was last year at the same time. I think kids are just freaked out. Like, they're worried about no trips. They're trying to lock their spots in. And so I'm definitely kind of predicting that a record number of decommitments will happen later on in the fall. But right now, recruiting is still going crazy. I think for me, the biggest difference is I'm off the road, which I enjoy going to different events and camps and combines and 7-on-7 events. And so not able to travel, not able to get out and see kids in person. And I think that in-person eval is kind of hurting not just us, but, you know, a lot of college coaches as well. They value that, you know, ability to see if that guy who's 6'4 isn't actually 6'1. So the job is still busy, just not as much in-person evals right now for me.
You know, it's interesting, too. If you see a player in person or play in person, you have a much different feeling about that guy from watching tape, and that's the truth. But there are great resources for parents to use, like Huddle and things like that. And of course, guys like you that know everything to get the message out there. Now, let's talk about Orange County and the sleeper teams, because you deal with people nationally a lot, like I do. And people want to talk about modern day. They want to talk about Bosco. They know about Oaks Christian. They know about some of the old school teams like Bishop Abbott, Loyola in Southern California. But in Orange County, we have public schools and private schools that play some serious football. And tonight we have an example of that.
I guess for me, I don't know if I'd call these sleeper teams, La Habra, San Clemente. These are elite teams, right? So are they modern day? No. Are they St. John Bosco? No. Is anybody? And those are the two top teams in the whole state of not just California, but probably the country as well. So, you know, Jaime Ortiz, Frank Mazzotta, two of the best coaches that you'll ever find. They play really good football. And again, not loaded with, you know, 15 or 16 D1 kids. But, you know, if you want to watch this well-coached, well-schemed, tough physical football, I mean, San Clemente and La Habra doesn't get any better than that.
We got the CIF championship from December 5th, 2015. Sam Darnold replaced by Jack Sears, a very, very solid Tritons team, and the Highlanders of La Habra. This is a great game, but it was on tape delay. It's Sam Farber's first game ever, and he's a heck of a talent. You work with him. Yeah, and no one really knew this game happened the way it did. It went deep into the night, and it ended in such a special way. Do you remember where you were on this night?
You know, so I went to a game. I can't remember what game I went to, though. I was kind of kicking myself trying to remember. But I remember driving home, right? And like I said, this was a TV game, so it was about a half hour delayed from my game. You know, I love Coach Mazzotta, but Jaime Ortiz is actually a friend of mine, right? So they lost the year before. That was Sam Darnold's senior year. So I knew they were playing in the final. And when I heard how it happened, I don't know, are we allowed to give away the answer to the test? Can we say what most people already know, right? There was the wild Hail Mary. When I heard what happened, I was heartbroken for my guy, Coach Ortiz. So I heard it. Literally, I was driving home. Probably shouldn't have been on my phone, but I was. I'll admit it. I was breaking the law, driving home on my phone, kind of get the updates. And I saw Hail Mary, you know, no time left on the clock. Eric Berrier making just a phenomenal player, because that's what he did. So, I heard about the ending just driving home from another game.
All right, let's tee it up. Let's get back to that fateful evening, Friday, December 4th, 2015. San Clemente and La Habra at Cerritos College, a fabled place where heroes are made. We got Sam Farber calling his first game ever, Lindsay Theory on the sideline, and Coach Ricks. Both teams are in the virtual locker room right now, and we are back with our guest tonight, the great Greg Biggins, the best recruiting analyst and the analyst for the game of the week out there, the best of the West, they say. Some say the entire country. Now, Greg, this has been a really cool first half because you saw the late turnover and just the efficient way Jack Sears led that team down and got a touchdown late. This was just a really great display of two efficient offenses. And one thing I thought Sam Farber said that was really interesting is the teams still huddle, especially La Habra. Do you still see a lot of teams that huddle up? We still see, you know, maybe one in every three in college football, depending on your personality. What's it like these days, especially in the OC?
Yeah, no, it's you don't see a whole lot of huddle. You don't see a whole lot of pro style anymore. I mean, I don't even know what pro style is. And obviously you do a ton of games, right? What is pro style now? Because you see, you know, gosh, Tom Brady's in the shotgun, what, 90% of the time? So used to be under center, five-step drops and seven-step drops. And, you know, my Elite 11 days with Bob Johnson, you know, it was all about pro style, meant pocket passing. But now it's spread, it's four wides. It's, you know, when you see, you know, you and I saw Modern Day, who was known for just Matt Grudegood, Mike McNair, tough, rugged, physical football, going air raid. You knew the game was changing radically.
It's very interesting because I would say pro style is, if you need to, you can bring a tight end and use a fullback. And that separates you and makes you a pro style team. Even if you're spread out, you can run the football. If you can't do that, you don't have any other options aside from airing it out and running delays, then you're not a pro-style team, I guess. that might be a modern-day definition of it. It's very weird, and times are always changing. One team that puts up incredible numbers, and we saw it with Big Play VA out of Alamany, and we're seeing it now with this La Habra quarterback that we're watching in this game, Berrier. This guy has a flair for the dramatic. When did you become aware of this player, and what a wild career he had as a Highlander?
So Coach Mazzotta was just adamant about how good his kid was, you know, and just, I don't get why he doesn't have any offers. And really he didn't. Eastern Washington was it. And, you know, I think parents and handlers and coaches, they don't always get, you know, college offers and NFL projection, how we do rankings. It's based on upside. It's a projection, not high school production. And obviously, they two should go together, right? The best college players, prospects, should also be the best high school kids. Doesn't always work that way. You know, Berrier was a 5'9", 5'10", quarterback with a good, not a great arm. He could run around and make plays. You kind of laughed a little bit, but my comp for him was Darren Hagan, going back old school, right? Because the way he runs around and makes guys miss, I think the arm is live enough, right? And he's at Eastern Washington right now balling. You know, he was a third-team All-American last year, and you know, he's got one more year left, but, you know, I probably first heard about him from Coach Mazzotta as a junior. He goes, hey, this kid is a special, special player. And he was, no doubt, a special high school player. And now he's doing, you know, big things at Eastern Washington. Remember Vernon Adams, who played for Dean Harrington, had a great career at Eastern Washington. So they do a great job, I think, Eastern Washington, of evaluating quarterbacks. They don't care about size. They just want ball players and guys who can make plays. And that was definitely Berrier.
And, of course, you see the toughness of Jack Sears in this game. He's joining a quarterback competition against Hank Bachmeier, another Southern California quarterback in Boise. What did he appear to be to you back then? You know your friendship with Coach Ortiz might have blinded you, Biggins.
So, I mean, the whole San Clemente quarterback tradition goes back to even Travis Wilson, right? Maybe even before him. The thing I love about the San Clemente kids and quarterbacks is I'm a fan of two-sport athletes. I'm a fan of toughness. And Darnold was an MVP basketball player. You know, his first offer, talk about Sam, was as a linebacker from Utah. Jack Sears didn't transfer out when he wasn't, you know, given the starting spot as a sophomore. He was an all-league receiver for Sam, took over the reins as a junior. And so for me, I value quarterbacks that can move around. You know, I'm a huge fan of toughness and playmaking. I don't want a statue. I want a guy who can move around and make plays. And you see it with Jack. You know, not the biggest arm, right? He looks like a Greek god, but not the biggest arm. But, man, just tough, right? You'll see in the second half, there was a driver. He literally called his own number every single time and just took up the middle. You know, just kept taking it, taking a shot after shot. And he didn't care, man. He kind of relished that. So I first heard about Jack from Coach Ortiz as a sophomore, as a receiver, quarterback to be. And then what a great career for San Clemente. Did what Sam Darnold couldn't do, right? That was lost this year. But the following year, CIF, regional, and a state championship for those Tritons. So Jack Sears, great high school quarterback.
Just a junior in this game, and it's all locked up at Cerritos College. How long does it take you to get there from your house, Biggie? And do you ever carpool with Eric Sondheimer? Because you know he's going to be there too.
I think Eric goes about 8 hours before I do, and I'm kind of a tailgate. I'm a man of the people, right? I like to go and tailgate with the fans and eat a little bit, maybe have a few non-alcoholic beverages before the game. So I'm not sure if you're being serious, but it's a 20-minute drive for me coming from the OC. But I love Cerritos College, man. I love the pregame tailgate. The game is secondary for me. It's all about the tailgates. So I did not go with their Eric Sondheimer. To answer the question, no. Never.
Let's get out back to the 2015 CIF Southwest Division Final. Tritons, Highlanders, there can only be one. Some got to win. Some got to lose. San Clemente got the blues. Greg Biggins, our guest. Where was he that night? He doesn't remember, but he remembers what happened. And that was a classic. Back and forth till the end. What a great effort by both teams in a game that will be talked about for decades in both areas and around Orange County. Biggie, that was a tough one to watch, I'm sure, for Coach Ortiz. And he still talks about this one, doesn't he?
So we talked earlier this week, and yeah, he's still, I mean, I think he's come, he's at peace right about now, 5 years later, right? But no, I brought up, you know, a couple key plays in the game, and he's still, you know, not convinced that there should have been a flag. And just to kind of reset on that, you know, kickoff, there's 20 seconds left. I love the idea. I don't know how you feel about this. I hate squib kicks, right? So there was that question, why didn't he just squib it? I feel like when you squib kick, you basically give the guy, you know, 30, 40 yards. So I kind of like kicking deep. They hadn't really returned one all year against San Clemente. But there was a big return to about the 45 and then a 15-yard penalty, which he swears. And I watched the game probably three or four times. I did not see a late hit or a pile on or any. So that gave him 15 more yards. And so Coach Ortiz was still upset about that. And then, you know, he's still not convinced that the receiver caught the ball in bounds. He was kind of going, I'm not even sure. I thought it was a good catch personally, but yeah, he's still, the funny thing was, so little segue, the next practice after this season, the first thing they worked on was Hail Mary defense. And he actually took over. He replaced his old DC with himself. So he became the DC and the head coach the following year when they did go ahead and win a CIF and the state title that next year.
Unbelievable information, and always great to talk to the immortal Greg Biggins, not just the Highlanders that night back in 2015. Biggie, you're the best, man. Congratulations on a great first year calling games. And we'll be checking everything out on 24/7. And we'll talk soon. Take care.
Yeah, I had fun doing it. Thanks, Pete.